This episode of First Principles is part two of our discussion on SQL Dialog. In part one, we covered the core AI technology behind Oracle Digital Assistant SQL Dialogs, which enables users to query databases through natural language queries. In part two, we're essentially going to talk about details of the SQL Dialog specific models, how we train them, as well as some of the techniques we use to avoid hallucinations. Joining me again today, we have Dr. Mark Johnson, Chief AI Scientist at Oracle Digital Assistant. Welcome, Mark.
Thanks, Pradeep. Very pleased to be here.
As you mentioned before, training for DNN of any form, particularly for natural languages, requires massive amounts of data, and it requires massive amount of compute. Can you talk about how we do the training for our SQL Dialog model?
If you want to build a DNN that is designed for a specific task, we don't need millions of training examples for that particular task. Instead, there's a technique that's called pre-training and fine-tuning that lets us start with a generic model that's trained on a large amount of training data and a generic task, and then fine-tune the model using a small amount of task-specific data. This simplifies the training process, since the same generic model can be leveraged to generate multiple types of task-specific models, and it significantly reduces the task-specific training data requirements.
So do SQL Dialog customers actually have to provide any form of training data at all?
We actually handle the training for our customers. We have different data sets that we use for the different stages of training that we just talked about. This lets SQL Dialogs run out of the box with no data supplied from the customer. And instead, we actually use the customer's information, in this case, the database schema from the customer's database, together with the customer's query to provide the necessary information that the SQL Dialogs model needs to produce the SQL output. For our SQL Dialogs product, we actually do allow customers to optionally provide in the order of around 100 examples. And this actually lets the customer support any unusual terminology that they may require. So for example, this would let the customer make show the most important locations translate into a SQL query for the highest total sales in the financial year.
Cool. So let's actually get into the nitty-gritty of the SQL Dialog model itself. How does it work?
The SQL Dialogs model is a pipeline that contains two deep learning models. Now, the input natural language utterance and the database schema process through an entity resolution model. And that picks out the key named entities inside of the user utterance and then links them to database schema elements and also database values in the customer database. That information forms the augmented natural language utterance, which is then actually fed into the deep learning semantic parser model. That's the DNN that I was just talking about. That produces an intermediate representation that we call Oracle Meaning Representation Language. And then finally, this Oracle Meaning Representation Language is converted into the SQL output using a rules-based processor. The SQL then is executed against the customer's database to generate the output that is then shown by the ODA chatbot back to the user. So we use the entity resolution machine learning model to establish relationships between the tokens or the words in the natural language utterance with entities in the customer's database. We use that input to actually bias the deep learning transformer models, the attention mechanism in those models for SQL Dialog. So as an example, the Big Apple would be recognized as an entity, as a geographical location, that's then actually mapped to New York. The semantic parser component is the deep learning DNN that takes the augmented input that's got the entities detected in it, and it's then used to produce a parse tree output in Oracle Meaning Representation Language. And Oracle Meaning Representation Language is the foundation for representing the SQL Dialogs output in a standardized or normalized form. And then the OMRL to SQL component is a rule-based transformation that takes the OMRL as input and converts that into SQL. So OMRL is a kind of intermediate representation language for queries that is similar to SQL, and it actually lets us handle joins in a standardized way.
So there's a lot going on here, it looks like, in our SQL Dialog Model. But, you know, Mark, one thing, why do we actually need to transform the natural language query into OMRL as an intermediate step? Why can't we just generate SQL directly?
The semantic parser generates OMRL as a structured object. And this actually allows us to use industry best practices, such as the parameter binding libraries that detect and foil SQL injection attacks when we're generating SQL. If we just directly generated a SQL string, we wouldn't be able to get these security benefits. So instead of treating SQL just as a string representation that we build up via concatenation, we use the parameter binding library, and that requires a structured input that we get from OMRL, where the structure is actually constrained by the OMRL grammar. Okay, so let's dive into a detail example here. What we're seeing here is that the parse structure output that's produced by the semantic parser is constrained by the OMRL grammar. And this actually prevents the model from directly generating insert, update, or any of the other unsafe SQL operations. And in fact, actually, it also stops even more subtle attacks. So in this diagram here, you'll see a nefarious user has tried to inject drop table employee in a query like find the average salary of developers in drop table employee. That might actually produce an OMRL representation such as the one shown in the screen here, but even there, then the parameter binding library would block that bad constant from being incorporated into the output SQL.
So obviously, you know, security is OCI's number one priority. Can you explain how OMRL is used beyond SQL generation?
Yeah. So I'd like to mention here another really important use of OMRL. It's what we call the interpretation component. One of the challenges of any generative AI system is that they're not always completely perfect. So for various reasons, the SQL that's generated might not exactly correspond to what the user had in mind. Perhaps their utterance was unclear or other issues like that. So we actually have added an additional component as the interpretation, OMRL to NL. And so that takes the OMRL output from the semantic parser and then generates a natural language utterance, which re-expresses the user's query. So this is extremely useful for users that don't know how to understand OMRL or SQL for that matter. So for example, suppose the semantic parser had made a mistake. Instead of giving the location of New York employees, it generated the Department of New York employees. So the answer would still be a list of employees, but it just simply wouldn't be the answer that the user wanted. And the interpretation component can let the user understand exactly which question the system is actually answering for them.
We talked about how SQL Dialogs is essentially using generative AI, using language models. And large language models like ChatGPT they are prone to hallucinations of various forms, and they can actually generate, incorrect output. But that's not something we want in SQL dialogs when we actually, generate SQL queries. How do you avoid hallucinations that are so common in language models like ChatGPT?
Certainly, large language models like ChatGPT are very prone to hallucination. That is, their output can include irrelevant, inappropriate, and just plain incorrect information. So our SQL dialog system, by its very design, actually is much less prone to hallucinations. And in fact, we've actually measured that hallucinations occur much less often in SQL dialogs than in general purpose large language models. I think the really big difference is the general purpose large language models actually have to produce arbitrary, unconstrained output as strings, whereas our SQL Dialog system produces constrained output, and it's structured, it's a parse. So in SQL Dialogs, we use a grammar that's derived from the database schema to constrain the output. And our SQL Dialog system's actually producing a parse tree against that grammar. The system can't produce arbitrary, unstructured output. I talked before about the entity preprocessor system, which detects the entities. And so we detect and follow those through the entire processing pipeline. You know, person names, product names, dates, geolocations, and so on. We detect them, we normalize them, we link them back to the database values, and we track them throughout the entire parsing process. And so we can prevent the parser from hallucinating a column or a value, which doesn't actually link back to an entity that the users actually mentioned in their query. And then finally, as a safety mechanism, we have this interpretation component that I just talked about, which re-expresses the OMRL back in a natural language form. And so while this is primarily intended to let the user recognize situations where the parser's misunderstood the user's request, it actually also lets the user detect situations where the parser has produced output that's not present in the original request. So any hallucinations would be easily detectable at that stage as well.
Got it. That makes sense. So essentially, we use a few different techniques. We have, you know, we as part of the parsing, semantic parsing, we leverage the fact that we know the database schema and then use that. And then we also use the name entity recognition. And then last but not the least, we actually, you know, generate, you know, somewhat of a natural language output as we have interpreted that from the OMRL so that users can essentially visually cross-check that. So essentially have belts and suspenders approach here to make sure that we're not hallucinating SQL queries. Thank you, Mark, for joining today.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
So just to quickly recap, we use generic training data and a somewhat of a generic model as the foundation for the SQL Dialog model. There may be some scenarios where a customer might have to, you know, train the model further, but to a large extent, customers don't need to bother. In terms of the SQL Dialog model itself, it's really a pipeline where we have multiple models that essentially, you know, take the input utterance, use the parse tree, and generate, you know, intermediate steps, and then finally an OMRL step, which then, you know, it gets converted into SQL. And the OMRL essentially is very useful in ensuring the security aspects of it, as well as some of the usability aspects of the SQL Dialog product itself. And then finally, we have multiple techniques to avoid hallucination and increase accuracy. And as a result, we essentially ensure that the output is actually with high fidelity.
Hey, did you like what you learned? Make sure to check out this video or this link, and of course, subscribe now.